I want to really start by expressing my condolences to those who have suffered really from the tragedy of when there is a police-involved shooting. I know that there is no greater loss, and I've expressed this individually to some of the family members I've visited with. There is no greater loss, I think, that any of us can imagine who are parents or close relatives than to have someone taken away from us under the kinds of conditions that we have seen. I would also say, though, having been briefly in law enforcement in a past life, that it is also a tragedy for the law enforcement officer. If anyone thinks that a law enforcement officer goes into their day or night at work and has a hope or an expectation or anything less than the dread of having to use force to resolve a situation, they are mistaken. So we're here to really explore, hopefully from many dimensions and perspectives, the use of force in our community when there's a law enforcement officer involved, the community's responsibilities, the community's rights, and at our very specific approaches, whether it's in policies or training or whatever the views are of how we can improve today on what we're doing so that we can be a community that hopefully is a model of a community that is inclusive and welcoming and respectful and can avoid these kinds of situations as much as possible. I'd like to say ever happening, but I just don't think that is realistic in the world that we live in today for a variety of reasons. So as we develop this this set of forms, and tonight is the first of three forms, we went out into the community through our online City Hall, Open City Hall forum, and asked folks to advise us on how they thought these discussions and this interaction could be most beneficial. And we had over 300 participants, and having read through the comments, I know that they were just about without exception, really thoughtful, helpful, and they've really, those comments have really helped shape what we'll be doing tonight and what we'll be doing over the next couple of forums. Tonight's event, we hope we can provide a foundation of information for these two upcoming dialogues that we'll be having and provide really a baseline for us going forward. All of the events, including this evening, are being filmed on Channel 17, which is the Salt Lake City TV station. So I invite you to go there. If you're having trouble sleeping at night, I can promise you this will cure insomnia. Except for with my mother. I can't quite understand that. But that'll be available on Channel 17 as well as ongoing comments through Open City Hall. And then I'll mention as well the two upcoming dialogues, and hopefully you got the sheet that was handed out upstairs, and if you haven't, I invite you to grab it on your way out or to certainly go to our website. The second dialogue we will focus, again, this is really in response largely to the public comment we received on the police training curriculum, and you'll be hearing some of that tonight, I think, through Chief Burbank. That'll be on March 4th from 6 to 8. 8 o'clock at Lincoln Elementary School. And then the third dialogue will be Know Your Rights, and that will be on March 18th at the Sorenson Unity Center over on 900 West. My hope is that these events really provide us with an opportunity for our community to come together and to share information and ideas and to help us continue to make Salt Lake City the best place to live, to work, and to recreate. I have always been a strong believer in a robust public discussion. I really believe that the more people we have involved, the more meaningful we have interaction with our community, the better results we will always get. And so I appreciate you participating tonight, and hopefully for you and others to participate in the forums to come. We're very fortunate, I think, in Salt Lake City to have a community that is as welcoming and inclusive as it is, and we've certainly shown that, I think, over and over again, I think, in leading the way as a local government in our state and in many instances even around the country in the way we approach governance and the way we approach our interactions. This is an issue that obviously generates incredible passion, and for very, very good reason. And tonight, I hope we can launch a discussion in a civil way and in a thoughtful way, and that we incorporate civility as the tone that we use in the discussions this evening and in the dialogues to come. We go so far in city government as to everyone who gets appointed to a board or commission is to ask them to sign a pledge of civility so that we can hopefully model among those of us who serve in city government that kind of practice. So I'm looking forward tonight on my part to really listening and learning with you from these dialogues. Now I'd like to introduce our moderator this evening, and he will introduce this distinguished panel that we have who will be speaking tonight. Dr. Robert Wadman is an emeritus professor of criminal justice at Weber State University. He is a prolific thinker and writer on the subject of community-based policing and issues involving crime prevention and justice. Not only has he served as a police officer and a police chief, not just in Utah, but in around the country. But as a university professor, he really has become a leader academically with many publications in academic journals, and he has written 7 books relating to law enforcement. So, very much appreciate him joining us and agreeing to serve as a moderator of this panel. He brings both great expertise and insight of his own that I think we'll all benefit from. So Dr. Wadman, thank you for joining us.
Thank you. It's a distinct pleasure for me to be here in this capacity, and as the mayor has outlined, we hope this can be a very productive discussion for us. The critical issues facing law enforcement are ever-changing. And the use of force has become a national issue. It has received a lot of media notoriety. And the issues that it involves, where there's a loss of life, are critical to every community that is involved with the policing functions. And I'm really in a position now to kind of reflect on this from a distance as a college professor rather than as an active participant. And sometimes that view gives you some insight that is meaningful. At the same time, I'm fully aware that the quality of what we receive from the community, people like you who are interested in what your city is involved in, what your police are involved in, your input is really critical to the success of what the future holds. Tonight, I hope we can have an active discussion that can actually help us in the process of developing a model that not only works well for the city of Salt Lake, but for the surrounding communities, and maybe even as a national model. I want to, as the mayor has indicated, we want to encourage your discussion, your input, and questions. We have city staff that will pick up the forums that you could ask your questions on, and as this evolves, we'll also open it up for just general discussion if the time permits. With that as a kind of a backdrop, my past, you know, I have a situation where my grandfather was a police officer, my father was a police lieutenant on the San Diego Police Department. I have two of our 4 children, 2 of our sons have been police officers, and I've come to the conclusion that it's a hereditary defect in our family that we go into that kind of work. Now, having said that, I think it's important that is everything in law enforcement on the right track? Well, with any organization, there's need for improvement. But the critical nature of law enforcement really requires that we have these public discussions and to have an open dialogue so that good input can be generated and from that good decisions reached. Is every comment going to be on target? Maybe not. But it's important that we encourage your input, and the ideas that you present, believe me, will not be just swept aside. They're going to be thoroughly reviewed, and a hopeful change or hopeful evaluation of how can we better handle things, what can we do that might reduce or prevent the need for the use of force, and if the use of force does occur, can we outline and present that information in a very transparent way so that there is a clear feeling in the community that law enforcement is on the right track and supportive of the community it serves. Now with that, I have the distinct honor to introduce our panel, and our first presenter is the Chief of Police for the city. And most of you, I'm sure, are aware of Chief Bradshaw's, this is kind of like what John Travolta and his, yeah, I'm right there with him. I've just, you know, my first meeting of the chief is today, and I followed his career basically from afar, but I want you to know he has a national reputation. It's quickly developing in a variety of areas of police service. He's nationally speaking around the nation. And Salt Lake City's Police Department is becoming a model for other police organizations to follow. And so it's a distinct privilege for me to have an opportunity to introduce the chief.
Thank you very much. The criminal justice system in the United States of America is broken. And it's no more broken today than it was 10 years ago, and I don't know if tomorrow it will be even more significant. But what we have is we have a system in which we incarcerate citizens of this nation at a higher rate than any other nation. We incarcerate individuals of color at an extremely high rate, in fact, a disproportionate rate. And I would dare say that that indicates there is bias in the system. And so the challenge before us today is how do we then correct this system and change? And absolutely, police departments across this nation participate in the criminal justice system. And it has always been my intent to do all I can for the Salt Lake City Police Department to ensure that we do our service without bias, without interjecting personal emotion into situations. The challenge, of course, that we face is we deal with people every single day. And there's not a person in this room, and there's not a person that works for me, because we are simply a microcosm of society. We draw police officers from mostly the population here within Salt Lake City and within the state of Utah. And these individuals bring with them their personal feelings, their emotions, their past, their bias, their prejudice, their feelings towards one another. And the goal is then to evaluate over about a year-long process in order to hire somebody to determine, one, if they have the capacity to set some of those feelings, emotions aside, and to actually be able to go out amongst the community and conduct one of the most difficult jobs in our nation today. The expectation for police officers should be extremely high. We should never tolerate poor police work. I have always held officers to an extremely high standard. But that standard cannot be an impossible standard. And as I said, absolutely there's responsibility that should be borne by every single person who wears a badge and represents their community in service as a police officer. But the dialogue also needs to look and evaluate what our expectation for policing is. As I said before, we send officers out into some of the most difficult situations involving emotion and oftentimes drug and alcohol abuse or addiction, as well as mental health issues. The majority of calls that our officers are involved in that evolve or devolve, for lack of a real word, into a use of force situation, are those unknown circumstances where somebody in the community calls and says, I have a problem, and I need you to interject yourself into those situations. every time that a police officer has to use force or has force used against them, that is a failure of our society. There is nothing successful about that interaction that takes place. And there's responsibility on both sides. There's responsibility from the community, from those individuals, and our expectation. And when I say the community, that's all of us. Because as I said before, police officers are a part of our community. They live amongst us and they work and play and participate with each one of us. In fact, the second goal for the police department in Salt Lake City is to humanize police officers. That is why I wear a uniform in most circumstances, because I'm not a suit and tie. I am a police officer, and I can be empathetic, and I can be articulate, and I can participate and be just the same. And that's very important for me to represent to my employees as well as to the public. Our officers receive 24 weeks of training before becoming a police officer in the classroom. That includes CIT, which is critical incident, or crisis intervention team training, which is mental health, in which they train with mental health professionals. This is something the Salt Lake City Police Department teaches throughout the state and throughout the region. It is important. It's a volunteer program everywhere else in the state, but in Salt Lake City. Because that is one of the critical things that de-escalates situations and, in fact, has made us better and caused the use of force to decline in Salt Lake City. Everything that we do, from responding to gatherings and protest circumstances, to engaging people on the street, to holding open and public dialogue, to releasing information, to putting body cameras on our officers, goes to de-escalate force. There is not one portion of our curriculum that I would say is more important than another. Treating individuals with respect and the dignity that they deserve is critical in order for us to be successful. Salt Lake City enjoys a tremendous relationship with the community in which we work and play. Will we make mistakes? Absolutely. Will we do everything we can to hold ourselves accountable for that? Yes, we will. But we need to evaluate, as citizens of Salt Lake City, as participants in Salt Lake City, how our city is policed. Not based on another part of the country, but what our personal expectation is for our interactions. That is what is most critical at this point and how we improve. And I notice my time is up. Thank you very much for your participation.
Thank you, Chief Burbank. Our next presenter is the Salt Lake County Attorney, District Attorney, Sid Gill. I've been very impressed with his work, and I think sometimes we don't realize how tough the decisions are that a district attorney has to make. And when police officers make mistakes and there's an investigation, to evaluate that and to balance what is best for the community and what is best for the police department and to reach those decisions is a really tough experience. And again, from afar, I've been very impressed with how the Salt Lake County attorney has handled this difficult responsibility.
Thank you. Thank you. The good thing about following Chief Burbank is he usually says everything that I want to say, so it makes it easier. But I want to start where what he started with, because I think this is important. Let me just share with you what I would like for tonight to be. I want us to have an honest conversation. I want us to have a productive conversation. This is not about blame, but this is an opportunity for us to think about how we can improve our community. The chief is right. We have a crisis in the criminal justice system. In the most macro sense, we jail more human beings than any other country in the world. We have a, through our criminal justice system, the criminalization of poverty, the criminalization of mental illness, the criminalization of minority communities, and that is a reality that we have. And we have to sort of address the core issues of why we do that. We also have to recognize that we have two very important interests here when it comes to the use of force issues in the criminal justice system. We have law enforcement, which is trying to do its job in a professional and honorable manner. We have citizens who feel disenfranchised, disconnected from their institutions. We have to recognize we have some very important concerns here. Let me give you an example, because perception is reality. And you know, one of the issues, for example, that we deal with, you know, if you have a police officer who's outside in a car on patrol and gets into a really nasty accident with a citizen, and there's liability issues, most law enforcement agencies will not self-investigate because there's a conflict of interest. When you have Officer Smith who's on patrol, he goes out on a domestic violence call, they knock on the door at the listed address, and it's Detective Jones from the same law enforcement. They don't investigate that because there is a conflict of interest. In the United States of America, there's three ways we can kill a human being. One is through the act of Congress, through the declaration of war. The second is through 30 years of appeals on a death penalty case. Or third, in a situation where a law enforcement officer pulls out his handgun and the course of their duty ends up having to use that lethal force. And when that happens, it is sometimes law enforcement, they say, we want to self-investigate. That's not to say that there's collusion, but there is certainly the seeds of perception of concern. And we need to recognize that reality when we're willing to put everything else out and when we want to circle the wagons. So what does that lend itself? It lends up to many themes that we need to probably talk about. You know, there are concerns about transparency, both in process and the information that is shared or not shared. There are concerns about accountability of individuals or the lack of it, not only in the context of individuals, but also institutional accountability. What are the proper checks and balances that are available to us? What kind of external controls are there? What kind of internal controls are there that we are aware of as citizens? This ultimately leads to an erosion of public trust, which citizens feel as a non-responsiveness from institutions and individuals. So we start looking at and concerned about, is the process shared openly and transparently, or is there a certain secrecy to it? Is the process closed? Is it transparent? And is the process immune from any kind of public input? And these are all legitimate issues. None of them by themselves, it means that there's an institutional conspiracy or collusion, but these are the concerns that our citizens have, and these are the concerns that every healthy democracy asks for, and we need to be able to address. We need to recognize, as the chief said, the notions of implicit bias that we have as individuals when we come in contact with certain minorities and certain populations. And that's something that we have to perpetually work at. We have to recognize that there's not only individual bias, but there can also be institutional bias, but not from having appropriate practices in place, not having or perpetuating a certain culture, or not having the oversight or or articulating specifically the expectations that we want to have. And that can happen, and there can be institutional bias. We have to recognize that the kind of solutions that we want to have, the conversations we want to have, there are macro solutions that we can talk about, and maybe we will a little bit later, that can help us change a broader sense of the culture that we are embedded in, to micro solutions of what specific things that agencies do and don't do. Now, my role as a public prosecutor is that I sort of straddle this space between law enforcement and our community. Here's something that most people may not realize. There is no legal requirement for me to do a review. This is a protocol that was established here. We do it, but we do it because, for me, it's an important conversation that we need to have. And that means that it's not about finding one result this way or another result this way, who accepts it, who doesn't accept it, but it's about trying to construct a process that in itself, at the end of the day, has to give you the result. Can we create a process that's legitimate? Can we create a process that's transparent? Can we create a process where you have input and conversation? We all have roles to play within that. The most important role is your role. In a participatory democracy, you help articulate what those rules ought to be, what the principles of accountability ought to be, and what those statutory frameworks ought to be when we look at and measure, when I am given the the four corners within which to review certain behaviors. So I know there's a lot of things that I've sort of mentioned in that sense, but those are the kind of things that certainly I've been thinking about, and those are the things that I hope we will discuss and touch upon today. So thank you for that opportunity.
Thank you very much. Our next presenter is Karen McCreary. She has an extensive background in community service prior to assuming her responsibilities as the executive director for the American Civil Liberties Union. It's been my pleasure to work with her on several different issues, and I'm really pleased that we have an opportunity to hear from her this evening.
Thank you. Karen. Yeah, thank you. You know, the American Civil Liberties Union exists across both the state and in every state across the country, really to be, we like to call, the guardians, of our liberties, of the Bill of Rights. And so, and that is kind of the framework we've worked for years on, police accountability, police systems, law enforcement. Everyone's mentioned our criminal justice system, and it is really exciting. I hope many of you have been following that we are really in a process of some deeper study and engagement in this state around criminal justice reform, and indeed have a package at the legislature this year that we've been working on, but many others, and came through our criminal justice system and corrections and governor to really look at how we can reduce incarceration and really move into a start to take some steps in this state to address what everyone's mentioned here about our broken criminal justice system. So I think these conversations here and the incidents that are happening in our state and country show, across the country, really show this another aspect of this criminal justice system that is absolutely essential. It's been a continuing issue, I'd say, for a number of years, which is probably forever, which is the relationship between our law enforcement. We really need and is an important part of a safe and functioning democracy, as well as individual rights that come, and individual responsibilities and rights, I guess I'd say, as a part of the community interacting with the police. So as we look at, our concerns here, and it's probably shocking to you as it was to me to read the reporter in the Tribune discover through looking at statistics, I wasn't aware of the level of, she termed, deaths, homicides that occurred in a sense. Second leading cause of that in our state over the last number of years has been really police officer involved shootings. So that's of course really troubling. So I think to start to really look deeper at that, what are some steps that we all can take that we need to be involved in? And we at the ACLU, I think there's a number of those, and I think we'll keep talking about those tonight. And I'm pleased to say, I think Salt Lake itself has, through the years, and with the police chief and Rick, who will talk, we have some good systems and processes in place here that are not in existence in other parts of the state. And I think, we have a community-oriented policing that Chief Burbank and the mayor and others have supported, which is important, which is, I think, a lot different often than what other police forces use. But it's not to say in any way that we're there, that we don't, I think, have a lot more that we can do. And so some of the things that we've been, suggesting and working on ourselves are enhancing, so this whole involvement of the community, of individuals, and the community we mean, all parts of the community. And as we become not only supposedly more diverse, but I also think we recognize diversity and variances in ways that we haven't before. And to really be in tune and to listen to people is essential, and to put into place structures that provide for real engagement and real conversation and real listening that's at a deeper level of trust is essential. And I think the structures are really important. So beginning point is the collection and maintenance of data. It's interesting, most police forces across our state, we don't have requirements for things that show use of force or that show, all sorts of different ways, the kinds of, stops and what races and ethnicity or when they occur. So if you get a way to measure and have uniform data that you can collect. So last year we worked, ACLU, with some partners to put in place statistics just on the use of force, like SWAT teams, 16 data points, so that we can begin to understand that across the state. And that's important because you can't move beyond, we all recognize, is their implicit institutional bias. to what really needs to be there, which is a lens and an understanding of what is the impact. That's what we need to focus on. You can't have equity, you can't have justice without understanding what the impact is. If you only look at, I'm non-discriminatory, this or that, we will never get there. So we need to really see the patterns and the practices by collecting and analyzing data. I think another important step is to have civilian review boards, and I know we have one here in Salt Lake, and I was going to say, I know that Rasmussen will be talking about that. West Valley City has another, but Utah in general lags way beyond the rest of the country without any kind of more independent review process that goes on to look at both individual officer involved shootings, but also we hope that there is an independent investigation role that's given and an opportunity to really study and look at needed policy changes, more systemic work that can be done. Oh, now I'm being told I only have a minute. It's like, hardly started. I'll just say really quickly, one other thing I'd like to make, we can talk about a little bit more. Because we have in Salt Lake some of these things already in place, I think it's really time for us to think more about how we can structure something more. So we look at some of the models that have happened in cities like Seattle that came apart about by virtue, and I will stop here in a minute, of agreements with the Department of Justice after some particular study had happened, a big incident that created a need to come and focus on policing. And some of those steps that have happened in cities like Seattle have been really important for establishing really great independent policing commissions of public that are representative of the diversity of the public, that are well educated, trained and understanding different roles, different people in the community, and bring to it a level of review and of study of accountability and the policies and the practices in a broader way than I think we really have in place right now in Salt Lake.
Our next presenter is Rick Rasmussen, who is the person responsible for Salt Lake's Civilian Review Board. And I can't emphasize enough the importance of that position. I want you to kind of stop and think for a moment. If you ask me, you're building a new home, and you ask me to come and hook up your natural gas line. I don't know anything about natural gas, but I think I'll give it a good shot. Now, is there some risk involved? Well, the technical knowledge that it takes to hook up a gas line is a microcosm of the technical knowledge that it takes to have a police officer function effectively in a community. When we're home sleeping, middle of the night, shots fired, those kinds of calls come in, and a police officer has to respond. And under those conditions, do they always make the best judgment? And when it needs to be evaluated, to have a civilian review board that not only wants to do that in a professional way, but also has the insight from a criminal justice perspective, is really essential. And Salt Lake is really on the cutting edge of having this kind of community-involved situation in concert with its police department. Rick's background as a retired FBI agent, spent many years here in the state, is well prepared for the responsibilities he has in that position.
Thank you. I'm the investigator and the administrator of our Salt Lake City Civilian Review Board. We're one of only two in the state, like has been spoken about before. We're somewhat unique in that we're independent. I work directly for the mayor, and I present the information that's gathered in my collateral investigation to a panel of five citizens that come off the Civilian Review Board. Civilian Review Board is made up of 14 individuals from the community. We currently have two people in training and another applicant, so we'll be full at 14. Two of each come from each council district. So we are, the idea is to represent across the community everybody who's available and has the time to be able to sit down and discuss these weighty subjects. We're governed by a city ordinance, which was put in place by previous Mayor Anderson, who set up the various powers and restrictions that we're operating under, as well as we're governed somewhat by state law on the things that we can and cannot do as it relates to state law. There's three types of civilian oversight currently in use in the United States. There's the Civilian Review Board that we have here. There's an ombudsman program like Denver uses, and then there's an auditor program. I personally believe that the Civilian Review Board is the best approach in that it's an independent review, it's a presentation to five citizens, and those citizens alone decide the fate of the case. They decide whether the subject officer violated policy or did not violate policy. And so it gives the community a way to give feedback to the police on all types of different offenses, from the most dramatic being officer-involved shootings, all the way down the scale. Each and every violation that comes into the Salt Lake City Police Department is reported to me. I get an electronic notification instantly. I have unfettered access to all records that the city has. I also have the ability to ask for additional information, additional interviews. Oftentimes you hear a discussion about subpoena power. We may not have subpoena power in the ordinance, but we have de facto subpoena power through the ability to communicate directly with the department and request additional information. And to date, it's been almost 7 years, I guess it'll be 7 years this weekend, I've not been told no. The way it actually works is as a case comes in, we run a parallel investigation alongside internal affairs. Unlike most cities and most oversight models, state of California, for instance, no one other than a police officer or a DA can directly question the witnesses, especially the police officers. We don't have that restriction here. I can question the witnesses, and I do, and I can question the police officers, and I do. And then that information is gathered, put into a report, and five members of the board sit down and decide on it. It's a very healthy check and balance on the current system. Like Karen said, there's only two in existence in the state, and ours is truly independent. Other states have additional emphasis on civilian oversight, but our city is, our model has worked effectively to the point where a year ago, the national convention of individuals involved in this pursuit gathered in Salt Lake City to hold their convention and talk about the latest trends and techniques and things like that. So the board, which is made up of dedicated citizens who volunteer their time, are doing a great job. They're providing great input to the police department. They're nationally recognized at the same time. And for that, I'm very proud of our abilities and what we do. In addition to what we normally do as it relates to a specific case, every quarter we publish every violation that came in about a police officer. It's publicly, it's posted on the city website, and the status of each and every one of those cases is there so that every individual involved can look and see what happened on their individual case. That transparency alone has resulted in good things because we've seen a dramatic decrease in the number of serious cases in the 7 years I've been here. So, thank you.
Thank you. At this point, we have received several questions that I think will be very interesting to hear our panel's responses to them. And what I'm hoping to do is I will present the questions to the panel, have a brief discussion, and then any comments that come from any of your additional questions that spin off of that, and then we'll go on to the next question. And I want to emphasize that our desire here is that data collection, a good opportunity for us to hear your insight, your view of something, even though maybe you're not directly involved in criminal justice, your view as a citizen might give us a perspective. Often effective change comes from outside the organization. And I'm hoping we'll have that opportunity. The first question, when is lethal force authorized and how can it be justified? And Sid, I think maybe that would go to your court.
Well, in the most layman term, you know, the way the statute's written, lethal force is authorized when a officer has a reason to believe that the use of deadly force is necessary to prevent death or serious bodily injury to themselves or others. There are other prongs that are there. For example, if you're in the process of effectuating an arrest or trying to prevent escape for a felony offense, then it's authorized. Then there, of course, there's a, in the statute it says, you know, lethal force is authorized in the context of if you, you know, in the context of the execution of a death penalty. But in the day-to-day average interactions, it is generally in the state of Utah, it is in the interaction with a citizen or a suspect where you exercise that force in the protection of others because you think the serious bodily injury or harm is going to come to them, or often in the context to an officer and their belief that there's reasonable belief that their life is in danger. That is sort of the layman's answer in terms of what in Utah.
Do you want any other comments?
If I can just add to this, and I think Sim will certainly echo this, that particular section of the statute does not afford a police officer any more ability to use deadly force than any citizen, right? Any citizen can utilize up to deadly force to protect themselves or another from what they believe to be an imminent threat of death or serious bodily injury.
Well, I think the only clarification I was doing, there is certainly the defense, the self-defense statute, which is available to everybody, but there is a very specific statute which is available and which is articulated as peace officers' use of deadly force. So those issues sort of converge. There is a, you know, the citizens have a right for self-defense, but within the context that there certainly is a very specific statute for also peace officers' use of deadly force as well.
Okay. Other comments? The next question is, when someone becomes a police officer, they go through extensive training, mental evaluations, physical fitness, etc. What about after that? Shouldn't they be found mentally and physically capable to do their jobs throughout their career?
Absolutely, yes. And that is part of the challenge of being, sorry about that, a police administrator is, you constantly evaluate that, and I know this has fallen under scrutiny and criticism as far as when officers are involved in critical incidents, that they are placed on administrative leave. Part of that is so that they can go through a process where that evaluation takes place. Are they physically fit? Are they sound in order to do the job? I believe there should be education standards throughout our profession. I believe there should be physical fitness requirements throughout our profession. And absolutely, there should be mental health evaluations that take place on a regular basis. And that's, again, part of the process that we go through constantly when we interact with the Civilian Review Board as we evaluate officers' actions and complaints that come in. We also keep statistics on what types of complaints come in on individual officers, and if they're specific certain ones, then we send them for evaluations. The question is, yes, what's going on here? Because we are subject, police officers are subject to some of the same issues and problems that anyone else in our society would have.
Okay. Other comments? You know, kind of, yes, sir.
Yes. I'm sorry, sir. There's 76-2-404, which is entitled as Peace Officer's Use of Deadly Force, and it builds upon notions of justification as a defense, which is in 76-2-401. So I think that there is certainly the legal theory of when you may come to the aid of another in terms of self-defense or self-defense of others, and there's the imminent use of force, and you can't be an aggressor, you can't, et cetera. There are certain provisions to that. But in 76-2-404, which is classified specifically as the peace officer's use of deadly force, it basically outlines the conditions in which the use of deadly force by a police officer is sort of justified or explained under our statutory framework. So I was just making the contrast between those two statutes.
Thank you. We would like to get through the people that have filled out their questionnaires first, and then we'll open it up to complete anybody in the audience that has additional comments. I wanted to add onto what Chief Burbank had added, that in Oakland, California, they had a requirement that police officers get back and run, grab the top of a 7-foot wall and then pull themselves over. And in the process of that, a lot of women could not do it, and a lot of smaller people, Hispanic people, Asian people, could not do it. And in a review of the Oakland's building code, it clearly stated in the building code that no one could build a fence over 6 feet high. And so these kinds of things often get found out in litigation, where people who have been denied employment opportunity file lawsuits and so on. And one of the challenges that, you know, I just simply ask you, will major change come to law enforcement by critical leadership, by good evaluation and research, or by legal action? And really, I think you know the answer. Much of the major change in American law enforcement has come about by legal action, and those are very expensive. And our goal here tonight is to avoid those kinds of issues, to be able to have good leadership and good input from the community, and in that combination, reach decisions that'll be effective for the community. Our next one is the Salt Lake Police Department willing to let independent investigators outside of the PD investigate use of force? Also, will the Salt Lake improve training to de-escalate, I'm sorry, I can't read the right, de-escalate these events?
So, yes, and we do just that by, as these gentlemen described, and allow people to have input into the process within Salt Lake City Police Department. And in fact, every single time that we have force used, especially specifically deadly force, the Civilian Review Board has the opportunity to review that, and they make a recommendation. That's the part that Rick didn't get to, is they make a recommendation to me before I make the decision on whether or not that individual's actions were appropriate within the policy and procedure. Now, we have separate steps here, so you understand. SIM's job is to determine if my officers are within the bounds of the law as described in the statute, the state statute that he put forth. My role is to decide if that individual, that employee, followed the proper rules and procedures of the police department. I have, in fact, disciplined officers that the Civilian Review Board has said, no, we think their actions are appropriate. I have terminated officers for use of force that SIM chose not to prosecute for reasons. So we have a good checks and balances system that takes place here. The description that SIM talked about as far as the process by which you review all shootings and everything else, Salt Lake City is absolutely participating and 100% with the district attorney and who wants to review our shootings and be involved in that process. I like the transparency of that. There's nothing to hide. And again, that goes to part of the cameras and everything else that we do. The process is a good, healthy process, and yes, we are willing to participate in that and are constantly looking to evaluate. One of the things that I think is very important to say is that Salt Lake City has a very low incident of use of force, and specifically deadly force. Now, that statistic means nothing if your family happens to be one of those individuals, and I recognize that. But what the challenges that we face is, I believe we do a very good job at training and preparing our officers. And absolutely, I'm willing to look to see how we can do a better job to reduce that very use of force that we're here to discuss tonight. But I think we also have to recognize that because of some of the things as described and not described that we do, that we have in place, CIT training and those types of things, we have less force used in Salt Lake City than many other agencies throughout the nation.
Okay. Let me just maybe contextualize that. It's important to sort of see the flow of it. So for example, an incident happens where there's the use of lethal force in our community. At that point, that the jurisdiction in which it happens is called the venue agency. So for example, we have multiple law enforcement agencies. And so that venue agency then invokes the use of force protocol, which is an agreement that started in Cannon's days, who was the district attorney, I think, with him. And that's been in place for many years. At that point, When it comes to the district attorney's office, though, so they, the host agency, the district attorney's office, send theoretically folks down who come, who show up there. We send our investigators. They have their host agency investigators. They get together and they gather that information. That is separate and distinct from what Rick may be doing or what other internal protocol with internal affairs might be. That information is gathered, then is presented to the district attorney's office. At that point, when we get it, one of the things that we've done when my administration came in, we changed sort of the practices when we came in. One of the things that we did, which what didn't happen before, and it caused some concerns initially, but I think has served well, is that we look at it, we review it, and then our findings that we have, we publish them. So they're on the website, they're open to anybody, and every time we make a decision, we publish the totality of our analysis. And we say, this is what we looked at, these were the facts that were presented, these are the whose witnesses we looked at, and this is why we reached the conclusion that we did. Now, when we do that, I look at it, and there's sort of three sort of options that I have. I have the option to find the shooting to be justified, that it was within the parameters of the statutory framework, and it is justified within as a defense that's available to the officer who used that force pursuant to the statute. Or it is not justified. And if it's not justified, then it invokes two other things for me to look at. If it's not justified, then I have to see if it's not justified, can criminal charges be brought against that that officer? And in that sense, you're looking at it and screening it to see if there is sufficient evidence, a reasonable likelihood of success at trial, the quantity and quality of the evidence, and the reasonable likelihood of success at trial. And or it is not justified, but I can't meet my threshold, my beyond a reasonable doubt standard in the prosecution of the case like I would in any other case. So for us, it's those three very distinct kind of scenarios. And sometimes you can have a person commit which is unjustified because they're outside of policy or in the statutory framework, but I can't reach the criminal intent for the filing of criminal charges. So for example, I'll give you an example. We had a case where a person who came upon a vehicle and used his weapon to fire into the vehicle to gain access to the car. That's not protected in the statute. And so it was unjustified, but it did not rise to a level of criminal conduct within the surrounding context of what we had. Now at that point, each different law enforcement agency does something different. They have their own administrative review process, and that's what the chief is talking about. Salt Lake City is actually quite robust in the way they look at, and that's something that's administrative. They'll look to see if they're within policy or outside policy, and what administrative action, if any, that they may or may not take. But that is sort of the process that goes through so people understand the context of what we're talking about.
And if I may just really briefly, so in that particular circumstance, I dismissed that officer and no longer works for me because I didn't feel his use of force was appropriate in that circumstance. Whether or not Sim decided to prosecute was not my decision, that's his decision. But the thing that I think is very important, because as you look at, I receive four independent investigations that come to me in order to make a final determination. So you have the Civilian Review Board, you have the District Attorney's Office, my detective unit, and my internal affairs unit also looks at this. And in the case where we have circumstances that involve another agency, I actually get five review independents that take place. But I think the thing that is important is under Sim's leadership, if you look at the letter that he puts forth when he determines whether or not an officer's actions were within the law, that is a very significant document that he has committed to making a public document. There is very little, if anything, that is excluded in that document as far as the description of everything and then the basis for his justification in that particular circumstance.
Our next question is going to head towards Rick Rasmussen. Who refers cases regarding police misconduct to the Civilian Review Board?
The ordinance established this board states that the complaint eventually has to enter the IA system. But the way the complaints come is in a multitude of ways. I get emails, there's an online electronic complaint form, I get telephone calls, but even more complaints come directly to the police department. Those complainants oftentimes are citizens, and in many cases, those complainants are also police officers who allege that one of their co-workers did something improper. But irregardless of the way the complaint arrives, they're all sent to me immediately. So there's no complaint that goes on in the Salt Lake Police Department that isn't immediately transmitted to the Salt Lake City Civilian Review Board. So the check and balance right there is, well, they're hiding the case, or the evidence is being, it can't be done the way that the electronic system is established. Complaints come from a myriad of sources and a myriad of ways, but they all arrive at the same destination every time.
And every single complaint, every year, we generate, the police department generates internally more complaints than we do externally from the public. And every complaint that comes into the police department is investigated, regardless of circumstance or anything else. It goes through the process, and we document those cases.
You know, I think it's an important thing to mention. For example, in San Diego, California, 70% of the complaints against police officers come from other police officers. I think the chief is echoing that.
Set of circumstances. And it really is kind of one of those things that builds esprit de corps in the organization, and is very beneficial that the respect for the organization outweighs the relationship of your colleagues if, in fact, it's going to hurt the organization. I think that's a very positive step.
Mr. Wallman, collateral things is that as they do their internal probe, sometimes what that also results in is that if they discover criminal conduct, then that case is forwarded to our office. So for example, our office then screens that, and there have been multiple situations where those issues of other criminal conduct on part of officers or somebody else is identified, then we go through the screening process and file criminal charges where appropriate.
Karen is much too relaxed, so I'm going to have to throw one her way.
We all know Christopher Soren, he turned in at some misconduct complaints and he got fired for. So that's kind of a counterpoint to what you guys are saying. Okay. And he believes so strongly in the misconduct, we all know what he said down the road.
What was the name of the
Christopher Dorn.
Okay.
The police officer
yes.
Got fired.
Oh, in Los Angeles. Yes, yes. In Los Angeles, yes.
Okay. This one, almost all of you mentioned implicit and biased, both interpersonal and institutional levels. How are you planning, or are you already doing, to work out prejudices, biases within your organization or departments? What is the difference between implicit and explicit bias for you?
I thought he was throwing this to you.
Oh, well, I'll just take it and throw it to you, because I do think listening to this, I mean, I guess I would just say, it's right, we have these institutions, we have that. And yet you look at statistics, communities of color have something like 70% do not feel that there's a good relationship so they can trust police. I'm not saying that necessarily in Salt Lake. I think various communities have had a higher level of distrust, and you hear that echoed, so that even though we have these independent reviews, what's to say, you know, how do we move beyond that? How do you all engage the community in ways that build trust, that really listen, that are much more, you know, this, what I want to say, you know, before these things occur, right? So that's really what it has to happen. It's not just the particular incidents. How do we strengthen and change this community of distrust in a way that we can really empower communities to have a more meaningful say? So I guess I would just raise that to you with that in terms of, is it just training? Is it, so implicit to explicit by it is, we all have biases. You can take, you know, little tests that show that. You may not even be aware of them. It's how they're manifested in results in the way that we view one another that really I think we need to be all of us focusing on, and where we've moved a lot in a lot of decision making by police and others, communities, to say what are the results of how our policies and practices are playing out in terms of the ways that people are impacted. So anyway, it's a little throw it back to you.
Oh no, absolutely. So the challenge that we face across the nation is we have for years used population statistics as benchmarking for whether or not you have bias or racial profiling taking place in an organization. And it's basically been, well, if you stop so many people of this race, and that's what the population looks like, then you don't have bias. That is a very short-sighted and very limited view of bias, and especially when you start talking implicit bias and what is the underlying surface. And so I am part of a task force generated out of the Department of Justice, one of four police chiefs, to actually come about, and there's a federal grant in place that we are developing statistical information to look at the relevance, and it includes searches. Who do you ask to search? Who do you not ask to search? Are there hit rates on the searches? This goes to stop and frisk in New York City and some of the other things that you've heard about around the country. And so the idea is to have a standard exactly like they put forth every year by the FBI that says this is how many crimes in the United States occurred in each city, and you get a big booklet that's published. Every single year there should be a booklet published that says this is the use of force that's used, this is the race and nationality, these are the number of searches that are conducted, these are the number of stops, these are the times that traffic tickets are written, so that you can start to get to, is there bias in an agency, and then how do you then prevent that? But you have to have, as Karen very appropriately pointed out, you have to have that statistical information in order to make that determination that does not currently exist and is not mandated throughout the nation.
Okay. I want to add a couple of things here just from an educational perspective, and that is if we look at the total population in the United States, what percent is African American? And it's 13%, and that's a stretch according to the last census. But what percent of the penitentiaries in America are African American? And that's 50%, actually 52% the last time I checked the numbers. So you have 13% of the population accounting for 50% of the people incarcerated. And as you think about that number, half of the 13% are women. And we don't lock up a lot of women in the United States. 94.6% of the people in the penitentiary are men. I mean, it's gender equality. We need to get this balanced, right? As you think about that, that means that 13% gets to be 6.5%, accounting for 50%. But what about children? A third of the African American population is children. And so that reduces it to 4.5% of America's population account for 50% of the people currently incarcerated in America. And this number, we hold the world's record. In all of Western Europe, England, France, Germany, Spain, the entire European Union, they incarcerate around 125 citizens per 100,000. Do you have any guess at how many citizens there's at 125 for the entire Western European area? What America's incarceration rate is per 100,000? 700, very good, 728. Now, stop and think about the cost. It costs more money for us to lock somebody up in the federal penitentiary than it does to send them to Harvard. Has this been a good deal for us? Is this a good purchase? Now, right now, that issue, we have more people locked up in penitentiaries in America than we do in the total population of five of our states. And it's expensive. It is very expensive. And how do we step back from this and identify a better way of dealing with it? And when you put this in terms of Salt Lake City police officers coming in contact with people, are they going to come in contact with people that are different than themselves? And are they prepared to do that? And the training that goes on, the average Utah police officer receives 15 weeks of training. The Salt Lake City Police Department has 24 weeks of training, which is a substantial increase in that training avenue. And for me, it's still not enough. I would push for substantially more than that just to deal with these issues in a much more effective manner. And I feel like I've taken advantage of the bully pulpit here with my... Let me give you another question. Let us try to answer another question. When do we not have the right to film officers on duty? What constitutes obstruction?
So let me answer quick and then let Karen do this. You can film any one of my officers anytime.
And that's been helpful, hasn't it? Yeah.
Like there's no movie rights. Okay, let's go to the next one. What standard issue weapon do Salt Lake policemen carry? After a civilian is shot, is there an evaluation of the other weapons or techniques that might have worked? Lessons learned as in industry?
Absolutely. So we carry a whole bunch of different tools around our belt. And deadly force is the very last option. Now, that does not mean that an officer goes through a process, a step-by-step process of trying everything out, because when does it rise to the circumstance that the officer's life is threatened? And so they are always held to the standard of what the other options were. That's part of the review that the Civilian Review Board takes place. That's part of the review that Sims office, my internal affairs, and my detective unit, in the case of deadly force, that they look at every single time. Every time an officer in the Salt Lake City Police Department utilizes a taser, the information from that device is downloaded, right? And we evaluate whether or not that was an appropriate use of that tool. One of the challenges that we've had in law enforcement, again, is the fact that we, when taser devices came out, when electronic control devices came out, they ran the gambit from if somebody looks sideways at a police officer all the way up to a substitute for deadly force. Well, we very quickly learned in this nation that neither one of those was right, that in the middle, at aggressive, active resistance, is where a tool that has some risk involved in it should be or can be deployed. And so that's the standard that we constantly look at in everything. But again, this also goes to the statistics that Karen talked about. We should be able to accurately produce at any time, this is the level of force that we use, this is the type of people that we use it on, and these are the circumstances, so that we can start to do the comparative analysis. Are we doing a good job, right? And so those are the types of things that we need to look at. I'm sorry.
What's the size of gun and a taser to officers carry? Do they have a nightstick? Is there anything else that they carry?
Yes, they carry a baton. They carry pepper spray.
Could have done to me the way I looked at it. The officer could have pulled a baton, could have pulled. You know,
ma'am, did you read?
Wait, no. Just hang on. I realized that this man was justified by the time that this situation got to the point where the officer was being hit with a snow shovel. He had no option but to defend himself. But how did he get to that point? I mean, it appeared to me in watching that video that there was time to have taken other action that would have prevented getting to that point, so that neither had the officer would have had to be harmed, nor would that man have had to be killed. And so I wonder, in a situation like that, what's the policy?
So did you read Sims' letter in this particular circumstance about the event and how it took place? So the officer was actually knocked off the porch, suffered a broken arm and a broken leg, and tried to use a taser and had that hit out of his hands. So
did he use his de-escalation skills at all?
No, he didn't. What happened to Alan Nelson? What happened to Alan Nelson? What happened to Alan Nelson and the taser? Thank you.
Let me interrupt for a minute. First of all, we want to have this be a productive opportunity for everyone.
You've been talking for 15, 30 minutes, a whole hour. These people got something to say.
Okay, I want to hear that, and I'm sure the rest of you want to hear that. The design of this forum is for us to collect information in an effective manner, and we'll have every opportunity to do that. I'm not gonna, try to intercede and defend
the process. I want to make sure everybody has a fair chance to speak and that we can air this kind of stuff out. It is a situation that's very difficult to take an individual event and take that into a policy. What we need to do is to look at these events and evaluate them closely, and we want your input. We also want this broader picture so we can develop good decisions for what the future holds and prevent these kinds of things from occurring. Now, I don't know, Chief, do you have an additional?
I think the question that you ask is a very legitimate question in the sense that whenever anything like this, a tragedy like this happens, either it's something that just happens, are we capable of learning from it in a proactive way so we can prevent those issues from coming? I think that's a very legitimate question that you're posing. So the question, which is not my subject matter expertise, but in the sense that, let me just put it out there, because I look at it in the context of the broader issue, because my focus becomes sometimes very narrow by the time I get to it. But I think there are law enforcement agencies certainly who look at it and say, from a tactical perspective, what is the lesson to be learned? And I know that Chief Burbank and I have talked about that, and that's something that they look at internally to themselves. But I think the question that you're posing is, okay, was there a need to get so close? What is the lesson of that? What is the, does it require two people? Now, when we look at it after the fact, there's certainly things that we can do. As I was talking with somebody yesterday, I said, we can go all the way back to say, when he got out of the car, maybe he should have waited for a second person. We can sort of go back and sort of do that. So the question really becomes, as a matter of internal training, you look at it and say, what do we learn from this? What can we proactively not engage in the future? What is the lesson learned? So I think the question that you're raising is a very valid and important one. And good agencies who are there will debrief on each use of force to say, what is the lesson to be here and how do we get ourselves into that situation? I think those are very practical things. I know that, I don't mean to speak for Chief Burbank, but I know at least we've had conversations where those issues have been an important part of the conversation. So let me just sort of, again, validate what you said. That is an important question, because we would be fools as a society if when these incidents occur and we do not learn from them in a proactive way, so we try to limit its repetition again. Okay.
I have a comment. I'm a black man living in Salt Lake, and I got to this country in 1996. 1997, as I was walking down in San Francisco, we're talking about Chinatown, where you have about 100,000 people, everybody out, trying to have fun. All of a sudden, there's four cars, and then five, and then six, and everybody with a gun drawn on me. And I'm standing there all ashamed, because I'm a citizen, and I have the right to be out and have fun just like everybody else. And here I am, a black man standing there with six cars and 12 cops gun drawn on me. Put your hands up. I said, no, I'm not putting, for what? For what? All of a sudden, there's two that came from behind and twisted my hands behind me. And come to find out, and then they violently got my wallet out, got my ID, gave it to the sergeant, and then came and gave it to me and said, I can go. Because there's a call that came in that there's a black man with a gun. So I'm part of this group. I must be searched, but there's no respect. They don't have to respect. They don't have to come out to, because I'm walking down empty hands. One cop can stop, excuse me, sir, come back, talk to me. They have the gun drawn, and I refuse to raise my hand. So I could have been shot, and it would be justified by police. But that's one incident. May I call this country my adoptive country? My birth country is West Africa, Togo. So you go through another experience there where the colonial power has put somebody on top of the country and they squeeze everybody else. And your hope is to get out of that situation and beware the right of the human being is respected. I'm driving on I-70 on my way to Colorado. This is 75 miles per hour highway. I see the officer coming on this side. I'm going east, he's going west. As soon as he saw me, because it's a lightning day, and I started using my camera before camera became popular on cell phones. So I pulled my camera out and filming these cops. He made a U-turn on the freeway and he's coming. And I'm speaking, this guy is not gonna take 2 minutes, he's gonna stop me. I'm filming him in the mirror. He got to my, and then all of a sudden the ugly blue, red, and yellow light came on. I pull over, I'm still filming. All of a sudden when he's coming closer, I got a camera out, the gun was out already, ready to shoot. I said, it's a camera, officer, it's a camera. And they pulled the camera out of my hand and got me out of the car. I'm asking, do you have the right to pull me out of my car? It did not respond. The camera is rolling, it's recording everything. So he got me out and walked me and asked me to come to his car, where he has all kind of guns. And standing on his side, now he's going to search on me. He has my ID and turned the camera away from us. I said, no, I want the camera on us. That's my witness. From there on, he started being so proper. So where do you say you're going? Hey, officer, I don't have to tell you nothing. You have not told me why you stopped me. Well, you were going 5 over. I said, can you put your gun on these big trucks coming? See how fast they're going. What I want police to understand is a black man is a dead man when he gets stopped until you let him go. Because nobody will go after the police the next day. It will be justified. They will go in my background and find something wrong and tell people this what he's done. My question is, how often do you recycle this young white male between 23 and 35? How often do you recycle them psychologically? And when they go on the field, who is on the phone with this man? I'm going to call it maybe a situation de-escalated. In the office, he's going to tell you what is going on. I'm at the place of the call. I see the suspect. Somebody got to be on the call, on the phone with this man. Because you cannot let every 22, 23 to 35 years old out there with a gun telling them, protect yourself. Yes, they're going to protect themselves, but the other person, that's why we have laws. Even a murderer got to go to court to be found guilty, and how long is he going to spend in prison? Now you have policemen deciding if you're going to live or die just because he has to go home. But the main reason why he's out there as policemen is to protect us.
Sir, I think you've hit the nail on the head with the last part. And I sincerely appreciate your comments. Now, I want to point out that this is probably a classic example of what has been called racial profiling, that here's an individual, African-American, who's stopped by the police and maybe not stopped for any real good reason, but yet in the perception of the officer, is there some, you know, psychological issue there that needs to be evaluated by the police department? And I think in Salt Lake, those kinds of training exercises are underway where those things are being addressed. I can't apologize for the law enforcement officer's behavior, but I apologize. I feel a sense of anxiety over that set of circumstances that you've had to experience that because police officers were not effectively trained. And it's disappointing that kind of stuff is still occurring, but our effort here tonight is to hear this kind of information and take the steps necessary to see if we can prevent it in the future. And your insight is appreciated.
I can apologize for the behavior of a police officer in that circumstance, and it's absolutely inappropriate. There's nothing about that encounter that you described, and I don't know if it was Wyoming Highway Patrol, Colorado, but there's nothing about that encounter that you described that is appropriate police work and should be tolerated. Not by you, not by our community, not by the police department that they represent. Yeah. And that is the problem that we face, because that particular officer should not be a police officer and does a black mark on every single one of us that says we treat people unfairly. And that's what we constantly have to fight and make sure that we do a better job than what you described.
And I think and I would echo everything that Chief Burbank has said. As a part of law enforcement and the community of that, I think we do owe apology to anybody who suffers that. But let me just share something with you also. I want to just sort of share this with you, because what you're talking about, and I can hear it in your voice, it is the experience of being dehumanized.
Yes.
It is the experience of being looked at as an object. It is the experience of saying that as a citizen, what is the value and virtue and the right that I have as a citizen, because the institutions that we empower are there to serve and protect us, not us live in fear of them. And that's a fundamental distinction. And so I understand, but I want to also echo that that conduct that happens with that law enforcement officer, the challenge is for us to make sure that we have elements in place in those public institutions where those accountabilities can happen, so that is not the culture. And when you go through that and you experience that, that is something you don't forget. I still remember after my first year in law school, I'm driving down in a beat up orange Ford Capri down in Oregon, and I have a police officer follow me into the city limits of La Grande, Oregon, and pull me over for no reason, and come down and go through the process of saying, but at that time, he stopped me, he started to start the question, I was very polite, he asked me, then he started to go into the litany of questions, and I said, and he asked me, he prefaced it by saying, can I ask you a personal question, then he went off. So I said, would you mind if I asked you a personal question? And he goes, sure. I go, I'm just curious, do you have probable cause? Do you have reasonable suspicion? Or is this an inchoate hunch on your part? Because I'm working on a project and I'm just curious what goes through the mind of a police officer. And he stopped and he paused. He goes, what project are you working on? I go, I'm in the process of writing an opinion for Supreme Court Justice Howe on the roadside encounters with law enforcement officers. And that was, and I wrote the opinion, I wrote the opinion, the first case that was State v. Johnson as a clerk. And I didn't mean it in a flippant way. It was very, but I meant it in a very important way. And there was a pause and said, you go ahead and have a great day, you'll be on your way. Now, I do that, I share that with you for two reasons. I share it with you for two reasons. One, I know what it felt like to be on the receiving end when you're looked at in that way. But I also share it with you because my experience has not been that that is definitive of all law enforcement. And there are many good men and women who do their job honorably and professionally and who care about it and who would not tolerate that behavior from another fellow law enforcement. Your point is valid. Our challenge is to have checks and balances in a public institution so those experiences become minimized and held accountable. But I also want you to know, having been on the receiving end and working on it, that that is not definitive of all, but I do understand what you mean.
A couple of things I'd like to comment. First of all, we have received substantial number of written questions, but I can't get through them all without taking up the time, and the spontaneous questions have been really productive. And I think what I'd like to do at this point is all those that have a written question, we will review them. If there's contact information, we will follow up with you. But at this point, I'd like to get more of that spontaneous stuff from the audience. There's a hand way in the back. Yes, sir.
Incarcerated, wouldn't we benefit in general from maybe less policing, maybe police just doing less, not getting in people's face and so forth? That's the first question. I'd like to defer an answer. The second question, sort of getting to the crux, let me call the shovel incident that we sort of know here. The chief has very pleasantly stated that the officer is not entitled to any greater use of force than the average citizen. But to Sim Gill, can we sit here, now I've seen the video, I have not read your opinion.
Sure.
But can we sit here with a straight face and say that had that been a citizen versus a citizen, that that individual who shot the man with the shovel wouldn't be charged with something here today? Isn't that the crux of the question?
I think the concern you raise is absolutely valid. And one of the things is, I look at, as I said, on 76, I have to put my glasses on, sorry, 76-2-404, which very clearly talks about the use of force by law enforcement officers. But having said that, I go through the analysis of a criminal filing the same way, whether there's a law enforcement officer or not a law enforcement officer. My office has filed charges in the use of deadly forces. My office has prosecuted police officers in other misconduct cases. And I look at it on the quantity, quality of evidence. And so I try not to make a distinction in the sense of saying that, that the police officers are granted some special immunity. I really try to look at it in a critical way. Having said that, I'll be the first one to own, I am not perfect. I can make mistakes, but I try to really, in a very thoughtful way, try to apply the law where I see it, and I try to call it like I see it, whether it's justified or unjustified. Yeah. But I thought I did answer the question, which is that I don't make a distinction. I look at the statute that's before me. I apply that statute in the first justification part. And when it comes to the criminal analysis, I make no distinction between a police officer or a citizen. That's on every prosecution of the case. If the elements were right and the conditions were right, of course, that there's a justification defense. 76-2-401 is a justification statute that's available to average citizens as well. You go through a case-by-case analysis. When it comes to the criminal component of it, I make no distinction between a citizen or a police officer in weighing the evidence.
Okay, all right. Thank you.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
In the context of that case there, and I can let Chief Burbank answer, but certainly for the when you are responding to a citizen's complaint, and you're in the course of an investigation, an officer is not unreasonable in asking for identification if they're conducting an investigation. And if you read the report in our findings. He indicated that he was responding to a citizen complaint. He was in the course of that investigation. Now, as I viewed that videotape, we can certainly say he should have done this, could have done this. I looked at it and I saw an officer in the line of duty. I saw a situation escalating very quickly, and it deteriorated very quickly. And my analysis came down to the point. To the point the officer made the decision to use lethal force and the context within which that lethal force was used. Now, having said that, you and I can certainly say, what is it that we should have done differently? What is it that we should be doing differently? Those are tactic issues. That's not what I look at. I do not have the luxury to look at tactics. Those are internal training issues. I look at within the application at the time the use of force was instigated.
Okay, thank you. We have a hand up here, and then I'll go up because we missed those up there. First here, and then up there. We'll get you. Okay, sir?
Yep. Testing. 1, 2.
Well, we're trying to get everybody's questions answered, and we've
okay.
I'll try to find your question.
Go ahead, sir. Quick question: as a Latino male here that lives in downtown, Chief Burbank, how do you plan on engaging the police department with the community so I don't have to fear going out at night and being shot by a police officer?
So we specifically train our police officers to interact with everybody. And no matter what their race is, no matter what their nationality, their belief, their gender identity, that an officer needs to engage in that. And I specifically think, as far as my direction to the officers and what we've demonstrated, that that is exactly how I do it. There's times when I take the opportunity to go out and be in front of the officers and say, this is how we're going to do business tonight. And the other times, it's direction through other people. What I won't tell you is that I don't have any officers on my police force that aren't biased. I can't tell you that tomorrow I won't have a bad incident. But what I can tell you is I will do everything I can to prevent that from occurring. And I think the Salt Lake City Police Department, especially specific to our Latino population and our position, my position on immigration and what we've put forth, that we will not ask these things. We will not, because it goes to the gentleman's question up here that he really didn't want an answer for. Policing is very difficult. And when we say, all right, we have high crime neighborhoods, so we're going to put more police officers in these neighborhoods, and then who do we encounter? It's not a matter of race. It becomes a matter of poverty. And so then we over-police poverty, because if anybody, right, if all of a sudden we're stopping everybody, we're engaging everybody, this is what took place in New York City with the stop and frisk, right? What is the cost to society to engage in police behavior like that? I don't agree with that tactic. In fact, I participated in the lawsuit against the city of New York for that. And so that's what I will do to make sure that that doesn't happen and that you are free to walk in Salt Lake City.
Okay. Let me get this gentleman's hand up here. Yes, sir, you.
Yeah, my name is Oscar Ross. I've been here for 34 years in Salt Lake City, Salt Lake and various communities. At the beginning of the program, you guys were kind of like really patting yourself on the back. I'm talking about Salt Lake fines, okay? What I'm asking you about is the Alan Nelson case. I don't know, I do know you guys settled out of court, but these people need to know what happened with the taser incident. Also, community from the circle that I gather around, they find you guys to be very distrustful, very deceitful, and you're not really giving us a full opportunity, such as myself on 111-09, getting back to that, Mr. Chief. I asked you time and time before, what were your results of that? And each time it has been evasive. So can you tell these people what you perceive, what happened on that evening to me, 111-09? Thank you.
Your case has been reviewed by the Internal Affairs Department.
But tell the people what happened.
By the Civilian Review Board, and we've gone over this time and time again. Now, the challenge that you face in anything, and this is the system that we live in, right? Our criminal justice system, the review process, is an adversarial system. Right? There is a prevailing party, and there is a party that does not prevail. And it is not, right? If you happen to be the party that does not prevail on either side of the issue, that is not necessarily satisfaction, but that does not mean that justice has not been served in the capacity that we have. Now, there's nobody on this panel who doesn't believe that we should change the criminal justice system, that we should improve. What Karen talked about as far as reducing the penalties associated with possession of drugs, I agree with that. We need to decriminalize these things. We have never solved addiction by policing. We've demonstrated this time and time again in this nation. There is a better way to do business, but that does not always mean, and in your particular case,
yes,
as I have said to you, on countless occasions, as my staff has said to you, the case has been reviewed, it's gone through the process, and you absolutely disagree with me. And you have the right to disagree, and you have the right to be upset that it did not come out the way you wanted to.
No,
but that process was fairly conducted.
It was unfair.
Okay, at this point, the gentleman up here, please.
Shot to death in the parking lot at 7-Eleven. The officer received a call, man with a gun at 7-Eleven. He waited across the street for backup. and then drove into the parking lot where he saw three young adult men, two of whom he could see their hands, one he could not see his hands. That young man began to walk away. The officer got out of his car, followed, ordered the man to stop, drew his weapon. When the young man, Dylan Taylor, finally did stop, he turned around, lifted his shirt to show the officer he had no gun and he was shot dead. The DA, the police department, and the Civilian Review Board all found that shooting was within the officer's purview because he felt his life was threatened. And he testified you all that he believed that he was dead, that by the time he pulled the trigger, he was too late. And so he shot Dylan Taylor, and yet Dylan Taylor didn't have a firearm. So it gets to this point where the officer, when he feels threatened, can protect himself and the public. That didn't seem to work too well in this case. So I'm wondering if in your training you can look toward a paradigm shift or, as Sinbiel says, some sort of learning mechanism that would help prevent such things. The other thing I'm wondering about is if indeed the officer believed there was a man with a gun, why would he exit his vehicle and go face to face with a man who he believed he had a gun rather than approach it in some way where there was some defense between him and the man who he thought had the gun? So I would like each and every one of the panel members to tell me what they think of this and how this shooting, because some people look at the shooting and they think that it just should not have happened and that the officer should be charged with some crime.
I want to point out we have probably 20 minutes remaining, and if we could kind of get the questions succinctly stated so that we can receive the information in an effective manner. I'll go with this lady here and then here, sir.
Okay.
Sorry.
So let's. I was waiting for. So I didn't know. You said ask, and so we're okay.
I'd like to each of you respond to that.
Okay. Do you want me to start?
Yeah. Go ahead, please.
Okay. First of all, let me start. That was probably one of the most difficult cases that I've reviewed personally. And I've reviewed a lot in the last little bit over 4 years, and I'm just starting my second term. I have reviewed almost over 50 officer-involved shooting cases in the last 4 years, and I've seen some very difficult ones, and that was probably one of the very most difficult ones that I personally have on a personal level. And also on a personal level, that doesn't make any easier, and the loss of life was something that I took very, very seriously on a personal level. On a professional level, given the four corners of the statute that I looked at, as I sat through with my senior staff and I went through, looked at the call that went out to the officer, the information that was available to him, the processing of that information, the steps that he took because he took the threat seriously, the backup that he waited for, the video cam that captured the initial response, the performance of the other two in comparison to the third person and how he perceived that, the secondary approaching officer who approached from the side, the walking away of the person, the line of sight that he had. And as I went frame by frame through the process, the turning of the head review and the eye contact that was made with the other officer who was also gun drawn because they were responding to a situation, and the what I saw as line of sight and acknowledgement and a failure to respond to the commands that were being given, the continuity of motion, the turning around with the still commands being said, and I take your point, what you're saying. He showed, pulled his the shirt up. He had his hands down. The manner in which he pulled and the hands came within the context of the totality of it all. It was again, a very close, very difficult call. But in the context of it, it was my conclusion that the officer was justified in that. Now, that is, again, you don't have to agree. I'm just laying it out like I saw it and as I went through it analytically. Okay? Listen,
We can get it one at a time so we can hear again, the responses.
I'm answering
please.
Let him answer.
Okay? Again, within the context, like I said, that was the analysis that I went through. That is the conclusion that I reached. And I understand that that's a very difficult one for people, and they may disagree, and I respect that. And I'm not making light of it, but that is the analysis that I went through, and that's why I justified it.
Yep.
Please. A really short question. Why don't the police officers ever shoot someone in the leg?
Yes.
The man with the sword that was shot in the back.
Okay.
I still can't forget about that. Why do you not shoot someone in the leg?
Let me answer that question. And I don't want to, get into my background, but through the San Diego Police Department training, through DEA, the Justice Department training as a DEA agent, as an Omaha police officer, as a Aurora, Illinois police officer, as a Wilmington, North Carolina police officer, in every training program I went through, all officers are taught to shoot at body mass. When you have your gun out, the ability to shoot and hit body mass is substantially better. And if you have your gun out, you know that it's a life and death situation. I cannot justify the behavior of these individual incidents, but I can answer the question. Officers are taught to shoot at body mass. Okay. Let me calm things down a minute so we can get to this lady's question. Has been you've had your hand up. Yes, ma'am.
So the person, Dylan, did not pull out a gun, neither did any of the other people. There was no incident. There was no evidence of them trying to hurt somebody with a gun. And then it is not against the law to have a gun. So for him not to be breaking a law, not to be threatening anybody, if he was going to use the gun to do some harm, he probably would have robbed the 7-Eleven or shot somebody in the 7-Eleven. So as the officers watched him go in the 7-Eleven, watched him come out of the 7-Eleven, I don't think they gave him a chance, and they shot so quickly. Again, if they think their life's in danger, nobody was in danger right there, except the officer thinking he was in danger because he thought the guy had a gun, when if he did, he would have used it in the 7-Eleven, or he would have waved it, or he would have done something with the gun.
And the dispatcher did not relay all the information from the call. Yeah. You can clearly hear someone in the background saying, oh, they didn't have a gun. The caller's like, these youth had a gun. The other person on the line said, no, there was no gun. You know what I mean? But the dispatcher's only, just like in the Tamir Rice case, the caller says twice, it looks like a toy gun. We got a black male with a gun. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You guys got to get yourself straight.
Calm down now. Let's kind of get productive questions. This lady's had her hand up.
From New York City. Apparently, and I heard this at a forum on this topic I was at last week, New York City, which has an enormous population, 3 times the population of Salt Lake City, apparently last year had 8 incidents of deadly force. In Utah last year, we had 14. So clearly, there are places where use of force has been reduced. Are there things that we can learn from New York City that we can apply to Utah? And if so, what are those things, and how do we start applying them now?
If I may answer, I don't want to. I'll give you even a closer example. Las Vegas. Las Vegas had a huge problem of officer-involved shootings that was there. It was a huge concern within the community. The Department of Justice was sort of working on the thing. They had come up with 75 specific recommendations, which the Las Vegas Police Department actually voluntarily sort of started to work on. In fact, one of the things that I'm going to be doing is just about a month ago, President Obama had signed after Post Ferguson and after the Eric Garner death, the executive order that was done for 21st century policing. So I actually met one of the chief deputies, Kirk Primus from Las Vegas, and I chatted a little bit. They have taken on a very proactive civic, they have a combination of things that they're doing. And in fact, I'm going to go down and visit with him so I can get at least a better understanding of it for myself. There is a civilian review component. There is a citizen involvement component. There is a training component. There is a reality-based training component. There is a implicit bias training aspect that is built into the training that's done. There is better open communications within the community. It has been a huge culture change. There has been training of supervisors. There is the issues of supervisor accountability within the interactions that are occurring to change the internal culture. So Las Vegas is a closer model, which was on the brink of that. And there is a whole host of things that they've done. You don't have to even go further than that. There was a DOJ study that came out about Albuquerque, New Mexico, after they were found to be in violation, after that community had paid almost $24 million in settlements. There were specific recommendations that were brought. So when I was called to testify in Cincinnati on this task force, I said that one of the biggest things that we can do is to do the culture change that we need to do. And we need to do it both at a macro level and at a micro level. The macro level is that we need to say, so different law enforcement agencies, not just one around the country, internalize this. One is that the Department of Justice should do random auditing of different law enforcement. They're right now complaint-driven. If they actually did random auditing, they would be actually prospectively driven, and that helps change the culture. The second thing that they should do is to create national standards of best practices, which constitutes best practices of any law enforcement agency. The DOJ has, in fact, I spoke with their acting person just in fact this last week. They're going to be producing a report on that within the next 4 to 6 weeks. And for the first time, starting to identify national best practices of what each law enforcement agency should bring in. So my testimony was that on a voluntary basis, each law enforcement agency should adhere to get a certification from the DOJ, and we talked about whether that can be implemented. The third thing is that we need to gather better statistics, because in this data-driven age, the fact that we do not have any meaningful statistics on the use of force nationally is abysmal, because it's just not explainable. So one of the things that you have to do is maybe tie federal funding as pass-through funds, because that data can be easily connected. That's at the macro level. At the micro level, you have to focus on specific training. You have to look at individual law enforcement agencies. Those that are doing great work need to be supported on that. They need to be complimented on that. But we should go through an annual, biannual review of what is our best practices that we're implementing. The third thing is citizen involvement. This is a participatory democracy. I work with a statutory framework, which is here. If that is not acceptable, then we should be all engaged in helping change that statutory framework, because that is your right as a citizen to engage in. But you have a role to play in that as well. And there are reforms that is occurring this legislative session. For example, there will be no longer, if the bill passes, that you'll be able to do self-investigation. The chief and myself and even Jim Winder, we've talked about creating at least a task force, and it's bringing other law enforcement agencies and partners into it so we can have a progressive task force to look at the best methodologies. So those are some of the examples. You don't have to go very far.
Let me make a...
Sorry, another. I agree, but I think a lot of what, I really appreciate this opportunity now that we're having tonight, is I do think their models, some of them come out from, a lot of them, from Department of Justice intervention with police forces, Seattle, New York, Los Angeles, Albuquerque, hopefully the future. that are models where, particularly now, there are some real studies and real, you know, I think some real things we can learn from about different kinds and ways of community involvement in partnership with people that are trusted, that represent across types of people in the community and have some specific tasks and responsibilities, engage in the community and work with police. And that might be something we could look at expanding here in Salt Lake. We have these individual components, but you can see in other places there have been effective additional things. And, you know, I think it's great to have these kind of conversations so we can explore some of the other ways that we might do it. And I think what prosecutor's saying here, Sim's saying is right. He's learning, looking at some of these examples. I think Las Vegas, it sounds like, has been looking at ways to broaden and deepen. And I would say really, you know, really put some real focus on responsibilities for community in a way that's meaningful. And one of the things I really liked about reading Seattle is to get in ways and study and conversation with some diverse people that represent a lot of parts of our community. And they don't, it's not simply black and white like some of these things we see. We're right, we have statutory frameworks. We also have a lot of other things that we need to engage in with a lot more understanding policy and hash them out sometimes that complements this. And I agree, I think, you know, it also goes to, we can continue to look at statutes and ordinances. But anyway, I think it's a really great question.
At this point, you know, our 2 hours has slipped by, and I just hope the rest of my life doesn't go this fast. The comments that you have made have been very productive, and I think we're going to learn a lot from this. And I want to remind the group that we have 2 other sessions coming up in March that we will listen for additional input in the course of it. At this point in time, I'd like to give our panel 1 minute each to kind of wrap things up, and then I'll turn it back over to the mayor. Rick, if you want to go.
I think the passion and the understanding of the situation that's facing the communities expressed here tonight is good. The ability to be able to speak your mind openly and freely and offer suggestions that'll make the system better. And that's what we're all striving for. And I think that the community as a whole will benefit from these type of community meetings, and we hope that you've gained something from it also.
What I would say is, let me say it this way. Just because I happen to be a public prosecutor and represent a public prosecution, I do not believe that the institution I represent is perfect. No institution is perfect. Every institution is subject to improvement. Every institution should strive for improvement. That is what the promise of democracy is. We don't get myopic, we don't get fixated, we don't simply say that change is not possible. Change is always healthy, change is always possible. Being a public servant means that as a part of a public institution, this institution is there to serve its citizens. The ultimate legitimacy and power belongs in you. The most fundamental thing that a public institution can do in whatever the execution of its duty is to engender what's called procedural fairness. It is not necessarily the outcome that you're going to agree with, but the sensibility that every citizen feels that the process by which that you have engaged and gotten to the end engenders a level of procedural fairness in the process that you are engaged in, because that is where legitimacy of that institution ultimately comes from. At the end of the day, whether you're talking about a public prosecutor or a law enforcement agent, what we can never forget is that we're part of a public institution. We have no independent existence separate from that public institution. And at the end of the day, the people that we serve is you. Our public institution cannot be a veto over your interest or over your concern. We have a job to do, but at the end of the day, it is to serve the citizens that we are, who give us the legitimacy of our actions.
Thank you, Chief.
As I started this, there is tremendous improvement that needs to take place in our system. Interestingly enough, as Karen described Seattle, I was one of the advisors to the Civil Rights Division in the Department of Justice in Seattle. And I think we need to work towards improving the system and how it manages. One of the things that I'm very proud of is what we've been able to accomplish to this point in Salt Lake City. Now, that doesn't mean that anyone sitting on this panel is willing to rest on what we've accomplished at this point, that we absolutely need to improve. But we also need to look and evaluate what goes on in Salt Lake City, what goes on in other places. I think everybody should have a civilian review board. I think everybody should have a process by which it's fair and open and accessible. I believe every police officer should have a camera on them. These are some of the things that I think are very important that I can only speak for Salt Lake City, but my commitment to you and to these individuals sitting with me who work with me on a regular basis to improve how we do business is to do just that. Work to become better at what we do and to set the example time and time again for some of the best practices that exist. And that's the approach that needs to be taken throughout our state and throughout our nation when it comes to law enforcement.
Yeah, I think I've stated before, I really do appreciate it. I think people being engaged, that is what we need. People learning, people asking questions, and I think figuring out ways to work within your local neighborhood, your community, to bring up these issues is absolutely what you need to be, what we need to be doing. Raising the issues, talking to our leaders, and really seeking better solutions often than where maybe we are right now. We're at the ACLU, we're gonna be doing some, bringing in some folks and like exploring different models of civilian review boards. As we said, we do have here in Salt Lake a good civilian review board model. But to look at others and some ways in which communities can be involved, we'll be doing that, continue to look at that in the spring as well. So we welcome your continued involvement. Thanks.
Thank you very much.
If I may, Mr. Waldman, just a quick point. The last thing is, it's very important that our policymakers help facilitate this kind of a conversation. We have as much to learn from you and share with you. And I just want to thank Mayor Becker for taking the time to start this dialogue, because these are the kind of dialogues I think civic leaders should be having on a daily basis. So, thank you.
I would like to make one last comment. In Omaha, Nebraska, a dispatcher gave a call to a police officer that a person was prying on the back of a drugstore, basically an OxyContin addict. The police officer responded. This individual turned and ran. The police officer fired two shots, hitting both times in the person's back. Some of the toughest decisions police executives ever make involve those kinds of decisions. The officer was arrested, prosecuted, and found not guilty by the jury. And every night a police officer's on the job, they kind of put an apple in a basket. We all do as citizens, we put those apples in a basket because we don't have to be out there on the street doing that. And that basket gets full. And when it gets in front of a jury, they might dump out a few of those apples, but often it still goes in favor of the officer. I want to commend you for being here, your commitment to the community, to be here and to be responsible in trying to help us make better decisions is very much appreciated. Mayor.
Well, let me again thank all of you for coming, for participating. Remind you, we have two more sessions. And tonight, I think we had this panel discussion to help provide information to you, to try to listen and respond to comments that you've been making. The next two sessions are going to truly be a more of a roundtable discussion. So we can be talking back and forth. And you know, there are benefits in both kinds of forums. So I really think that tonight's forum was good in terms of hopefully people understanding what the procedures are, what the protocols are, what we do, and then getting input on things that you believe we can do better. So I want to invite you to do this. Whether you're able to come to the forums or not, or invite other people to come to the forums, I want to encourage you to participate. And if that doesn't work for you, please participate by coming on to our website, providing comments, sending us emails, writing hand notes, whatever works for you in terms of a way for us to get input from you so that we can improve what we're doing. And finally, I want to thank our panel and Dr. Wadman because one of the things that I felt and appreciated sitting here and listening tonight, which I can tell you I enjoy doing far more than speaking, is that we genuinely have a group of folks who are committed to our community, to responding in the roles that they play, and to protecting our community. And if there's one goal that I think I have for Salt Lake City, it is that we are a welcoming, inclusive, respectful community from our positions reaching out to you, and hopefully as much as we can for you folks approaching us with ideas. So I want to thank the panelists here and Dr. Wadman. And I want to invite you truly to keep participating with us. The way we're going to keep improving our community and to having the best policies and efforts and approaches that we take is really by this kind of input with the dialogues that we have. And I can tell you, we'll be following up. So thank you all for tonight, and we'll look forward to more sessions.